Time for questions and minister statements, and I will call Mr. Edishank with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Transport Infrastructure in the other place. The recent federal government's strategic review of the infrastructure investment program showed the federal government's commitment to partner with Victoria to build the Melbourne Airport Rail Link. This is good news for the people of the western suburbs. It will certainly result in improved public transport connections in the west as vital transport infrastructure projects such as the redevelopment of Sunshine Station are linked to the airport rail link, airport link. So my question to the minister is, will the Allan government commit to funding the development of the Melbourne Airport Rail Link?
Minister.
Thanks very much, President. Thank you, Mr. Edishank, for that question, and I will seek an answer from the minister in the other place in accordance with the standing orders.
Mr. Edishank.
I thank Ms. Shing for her response on behalf of the Minister for Transport Infrastructure. By way of a supplementary question, the Melbourne Airport Rail Project is effectively linked to a range of key transport infrastructure in the west, including the Sunshine Station precinct and Albion Station redevelopments. By way of supplementary, if the Allan government will not or cannot commit to the airport rail link, will it commit to funding promised critical upgrades to projects such as those at Albion and Sunshine Stations?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Edishank, for that supplementary. And again, I will seek an answer for you in accordance with the standing orders.
Ms. Crozier.
Thank you, President. President, my question is to the Minister for Mental Health. Minister, in 2016, the Victorian Government launched the 10-year suicide prevention strategy. This included a commitment by the government to halve the number of deaths by suicide in Victoria by 2025. Tragically, the government has failed this target. Rather than half the suicide rate, there have already been five more deaths to suicide this year than in 2016. Minister, why has the government broken its promise to halve the suicide rate?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Crozier for her question. And of course, from the outset, I want to acknowledge how sensitive and how distressing these issues can be for those people in the community who have tragically lost a loved one to suicide. And of course, each death by suicide is one too many. And I think that there's absolutely no doubt in my mind that it's an area of policy that we need to continue to make every effort to have an impact on, a positive impact on, in our community. That's one of the reasons why we are working so hard to reform our mental health system through the significant report through the Royal Commission into Mental Health and Wellbeing, the 74 recommendations that flow from that Royal Commission, and certainly suicide prevention is a big focus of that work. We have committed significant resources to address suicide and to help promote prevention, particularly for rural and regional communities where we know there is a particular issue that needs to be addressed. In terms of the number of suicides that have been reported, of course the coroner does report annually the number of suicides that we see in the community, and those figures are troubling. And I acknowledge that there has been an increase in those numbers. Obviously the factors that contribute to suicide are often very complex. And so for that reason, I don't think it's wise for us to draw conclusions about the reasons behind those numbers. But what I will say is that behind those numbers is the stories of individuals and their loved ones, and the government remains absolutely committed to doing whatever we can in terms of both our direct investments into this area and our continued implementation of the Royal Commission recommendations to make sure that we do everything we can to try to address this issue in the community.
Crozier, supplementary.
Thank you, President. Minister, thank you for your response. And yes, it is a complex issue, and of course there are many factors and unfortunately the lockdowns and other aspects that have contributed to too many people tragically taking their lives. Last year was the highest number of Victorian deaths by suicide on record, yet there have been 25 more tragic deaths by suicide this year than the same time last year. So, Minister, why can't Victorians in distress get the mental health support they desperately need?
Minister.
Thank you, Ms Crozier, for your supplementary question. I do want to reiterate that I personally don't want to draw any conclusions about the what can often be very complex reasons behind each of these statistics. And as I've said, behind these statistics is the kind of tragic aftermath of these events. And in the rebuilding of the mental health system in Victoria, there's been a very strong focus through the recommendations of the Royal Commission on early intervention and making sure, well, I'm answering your question, so if you let me continue, by making sure that regardless of where you live or in the state, that you have access to local services throughout the community. And that goes to a number of the key recommendations contained in the Royal Commission, which our government has been continuing to roll out, including the locals, including increasing acute beds, and including building the supports that we need to address suicide in our
community.
Thank
you, Minister. Time's expired. Minister Statement.
Thank you very much, President. And recently I had the pleasure of joining the Victorian Multicultural Commission and members of our multicultural and multi-faith communities to mark the 40th anniversary of the VMC's establishment. Since its coming together in 1983 under the Kaine Labor government, following the passage of the inaugural Ethnic Affairs Commission Act in 1982, the VMC has acted as a critical leader and an active voice for the community. Forming close links between multicultural and multi-faith communities and the Victorian government, the VMC has advocated for the diverse communities that call our state home. It's played a vital role in promoting and celebrating cultural diversity within Victoria, providing the missing piece of the policy puzzle, forging connections and giving voice and visibility to communities that might be otherwise marginalised in policy debates and development. Victoria is one of the most culturally diverse societies in the world, with almost half of Victorians either born overseas or who have a parent who were born overseas. The Allan Labor government believes that Victoria's diversity is one of our greatest strengths. We're committed to working to ensure positive and equitable outcomes for all Victorians, work that remains ongoing. As we mark this important milestone, I thank the chairperson, Viv Nguyen, commissioners and staff at the VMC for bringing our community closer together over the past four decades, working to create a stronger sense of belonging for all and contributing to a more inclusive and fairer Victoria.
Yeah. Ms Broad with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Housing. A tragedy is happening in Bendigo for a mother and her four children, two of which have autism, one non-verbal. They've been given notice to vacate their rental home because it is being sold. She's unsuccessfully applied for 320 rental homes. The family needs to stay in the Bendigo area as one of her children attends a specialist school and they depend on local health services. This mother is concerned she may need to put her children in care if she cannot find a house to rent. Can the Minister please assist this family find a home in the Bendigo region before this family is torn apart?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Ms Broad, for that question. It's a question of significance not just for this family, but also for so many families around the state who are facing real challenges around rental affordability. And we know that some of those issues come about because of an increased cost of living. There are also challenges arising from a range of other factors. And every year we support at least 100,000 people with programs and services around homelessness, around rough sleeping. And we're doing an awful lot of work within the social housing space as well. And adjacent to that within crisis accommodations and supports. Without having additional detail about the example that you've provided, it's difficult for me to be able to provide assistance now on my feet. I am, however, very happy to look into this matter to see what can be done to assist the person who you've raised in your question and her circumstances and those of her kids. Proximity to school and to education is of particular importance, and that importance is only augmented when we know that kids have particular needs, including for neurodivergent kids who rely upon routine and on established relationships in order to be able to continue to attend and to make progress in an educational setting. So I am very happy to take some further details from you and to look into that matter, as I'm also really very available to do the same for any other member who may have particular questions or concerns, particularly as we head into the festive season and particularly as we have peaks in holiday demand for housing in rural and regional Victoria and in various coastal areas where available rental stock is also already at short supply. Let me see what I can do to find some further answers and to, if those connections are not already established, link this person up with services and with support that are available through a range of different service providers.
Ms. Broad, supplementary.
Thank you, Minister. I appreciate that. And I have been given, well, she's given me permission to pass on the details. In February this year, the government announced that work was starting on building a village at Flora Hill to accommodate 1,600 people. The government cancelled this tender soon after cancelling the Commonwealth Games and has since committed to building 1,300 social and affordable homes in regional Victoria, including Bendigo. Can the Minister inform the Bendigo community when these homes will be completed and those desperate for housing will be able to start moving in?
A roof over your head, that's what it's
called. Oh, and I respect the seriousness of the topic, but I am concerned it's not. The question isn't supplementary to what was asked in the substantive question. Yeah. I invite Ms. Broad if or the other thing is the Minister can answer as she sees fit. Yeah, the Minister can answer as she sees fit.
Thank you for that supplementary question. And noting that, again, I don't want to create a link between the substantive question, where it doesn't relate to social and affordable housing, or where it may not relate, and the supplementary question, which is centred around social and affordable housing. So that's just an important distinction to make, and again, I will look into that matter you've raised. The big housing build, which already has a $1.25 billion allocation, has been added to with that $1 billion commitment as part of the regional package, which is to bring at least 1,300 additional homes to rural and regional Victoria. There is ongoing work happening on not just those sites that were identified across Ballarat, Bendigo, Geelong and Morwell, as well as the other work on worker accommodation, which is part of the $150 million fund administered under Regional Development Victoria. I'm very happy to provide you with information and with updates on the work associated with that work, but again, what this looks like more broadly as accommodation goes immediately to its final locations.
Mr. Davis with a question, please.
President, my question is for the Minister for Housing, and I ask, has the Minister or her department undertaken a stock take of how many public and social housing dwellings have gas appliances? And if so, how many are there?
Minister.
Thank you.
Order. Order. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Davis, for that question. One of the things that we have done throughout public housing and throughout community housing, thus overarchingly social housing, is to make sure that we are providing as much support as possible to people, including on energy efficient upgrades. And with that in mind, I just want to confirm that one of the first things that I did when I was sworn in as the Minister for Housing was to seek information on upgrades and improvements to energy efficiency, and noting also, Mr. Davis, that as part of the big housing build, we have addressed the issue of affordability, including with all electric appliances at new at new social housing dwellings that have come about, including through the ground lease model, and of course all homes built on and from the 1st of January next year will be all electric in accordance with the gas substitution roadmap. So the energy efficiency and social housing program, Mr. Davis, is part of a $447 million energy efficiency upgrade for homes program. This is about delivering upgrades to public and community housing properties, and they include the work that we're doing around reverse cycle air conditioning, improvements to thermal performance through ceiling insulation and draft.
Mr. Davis,
I'm interested in what the Minister is saying, but it's actually separate from the question that was asked. It was a very specific question about...
The suggestion took it in an entirely different direction, Mr. Davis, you know that.
It's a very specific question about whether there's been an audit.
Mr. Davis,
and if so, how many is...
I'll call the Minister to the question.
So again, Mr. Davis, if you were actually interested in the work that's being done to reduce the energy footprints and therefore the cost of living for people in social housing, then you would have been listening to the answer, including as it relates to responses to interjections about the work that we're doing overall with amenity and livability and design standards for social housing. Mr. Davis, upgrades, as I was saying, to homes within the stock that we currently have include thermal performance of homes, include ceiling insulation, draft and gap ceiling. The average upgrade is being done at a cost of less than $3,000. The Commonwealth has also provided an additional $46 million for energy efficiency and social housing in Victoria. And Mr. Davis, I would be really pleased to, well, I'm not going to take you around to these locations, but perhaps to arrange for you to visit some of the sites where electric and induction cooktops are part of the...
Very narrow, specific question about whether an audit had been conducted and how many had gas appliances. And it was not a broad question. And whilst all of that is interesting, it's not an answer to the question.
I'll call the Minister back to the question.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. So in the aggregate, a total of 18,285 homes have had energy efficiency upgrades completed across the state under the program I've referred to as at the end of September 2023.
Mr. Davis, a supplementary question?
I noticed, President, that the Minister still has not answered this very specific question. I understand if she didn't know the exact number now and want to take it on notice. That's absolutely logical, but just to ignore it is not right. And I therefore ask, is it the policy of the government and Homes Victoria to replace existing gas appliances in all public and social housing? And if so, how much has been allocated for this task and in how many properties?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Further to the interesting answer, Mr. Davis, on energy efficiency across social housing, as you've described it, it's important to note that all of the new housing that we develop, including across the social housing estate, which involves a 10% uplift as part of the redevelopment of the 44 tower sites in metropolitan Melbourne, will have electric energy available under those rebuilds. All new builds from the 1st of January next year will have that, and we've provided ongoing support and energy efficiency upgrades to existing stock around the state as part of energy efficiency investments that we're making. The bottom line, Mr. Davis, is that this work is ongoing and that this is part of an overarching commitment to making sure that people can get electricity and other bills that come in that are significantly below that what they would otherwise have been under a government like yours.
Mr. Davis, on a point of order.
I did very specifically ask whether, you know, how much has been allocated to this task.
The Minister was being relevant to the question. Minister. Minister Tini, Minister Stephen.
Thank you, President. 2023 has demonstrated the power and purpose of Victoria's TAFE and training sector. This was absolutely on show at the recent Australian Training Awards, Apprenticeship Training Awards and Learn Local Awards, where the variety and depth of training and skills in Victoria shone brightly. These awards made it very clear that our skills and TAFE system is relevant, connected, aligned with industry, embedded in community, and delivering the skills needed to get rewarding careers. Yeah. The Australian Training Awards were recently presented in Hobart, and I am so proud of every finalist, especially our Gold Award winners, the Women in Apprenticeships Victoria Electrical Program, who received the Industry Collaboration Award, and the Beauford and Skipton Health Service, who received the Small Employer of the Year Award Victoria for delivering excellence in industry-aligned skills and training. I must also mention our very own Mary Farone, CEO of Holmes Glen TAFE, who won the Outstanding Achievement in Vet and Skills Sector Award. Yes, I was. Skills and training is about people. The recent Learn Local Awards and Apprentice Training Awards highlighted what people can do and achieve. All Learn Local Award finalists demonstrated the importance of foundation and workplace skills designed to meet local community need. Our apprentices demonstrated that their qualifications are valued and have earned them great skills that are in demand. President, I applaud every finalist and would like to congratulate every winner from these awards. Under this government, every part of Victoria's skills and training system gets the recognition it so richly deserves, President.
We have
the best asset we've got, Mr. McKinnon.
Order. No. We have got a member away that was going to ask a question, so we're only going to have seven questions. But now, Mr. McGowan, you fulfilled our eighth. So thank you. Ms. Coffey with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question today is to the Attorney General. The Office of the Victorian Information Commissioner, OVIC, has suffered budget cuts and been forced to make redundancies. The Freedom of Information Act obliges OVIC to conduct an independent review of professional standards for FOI at least every 4 years. These standards apply to all Victorian agencies subject to the FOI Act and aim to ensure the Act is administered by agencies in a way consistent with the objects of the Act. The professional standards review was due to be completed this week, but because of budget cuts, OVIC doesn't have enough funding to comply with the Act. Attorney, will you provide more funding to OVIC to ensure it can meet its statutory obligations, including independent FOI professional standards reviews, consistent with the recommendation of the report into the performance of Victoria's integrity agencies?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Ms. Copsey for her question. And of course, it is my responsibility to support agencies to fulfil their statutory obligations. I'm happy to have a conversation in relation to OVIC's priorities and in relation to that matter. I can assure you, in relation to freedom of information, it's a matter that has been discussed with me and the former Information Commissioner and led to the request for the IOC to undertake a review of freedom of information laws in Victoria to ensure that they're modern, fit for purpose, and we look forward to the findings of that report in relation to any future changes that we need to make. It is incumbent upon the Department of Justice to work with OVIC in relation to their budget and to ensure that they are supported to perform their duties whilst also meeting savings targets and ensuring that government is focusing its resources as the public would expect us to do so.
Ms. Copsey on the supplementary.
Thank you, Attorney, for your answer, and I look forward to continuing that conversation. The report into the performance of Victoria's integrity agencies was clear that there are concerns about OVIC's ability to fulfil its statutory obligations and to meet expectations around timeliness and performance in relation to FOI should funding not be available. Do you accept that if we do not properly fund OVIC, the performance of Victoria's freedom of information regime will continue to worsen?
I think that might be asking for an opinion. I'll call the minister and she can answer if she sees fit.
Ms. Copsey, I guess I can just give you an assurance that I'm always happy to work with agencies in relation to their duties, their challenges, their priorities, and their requests for legislative reform as well as budget.
Yep.
Mr. Lembrick, with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister representing the Treasurer. The Auditor-General's report on the annual financial report of the State of Victoria 22-23 highlighted some serious financial concerns looming on the horizon. State debt is at an all-time high, and the Victoria General Government sector debt is the worst in the country. It also said, and I quote, "The government have not laid out a plan for when and how the state will pay down this and future debt. Without a plan, further additional unplanned debt may occur, or announced government priorities may need to be curtailed," end quote. My question to the Treasurer is, what is the government's plan for addressing the state's runaway debt?
Minister.
Thank you, Premier. Mr. Lembrick, I will pass your question on to the Treasurer, and I'm sure he'd be happy to not only respond, but more than happy to catch up with you on these matters.
Mr. Lembrick, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Attorney for passing that on. I would also like to point out a win that was identified in the Auditor General's report. The general government sector's operating cash resulted in a surplus of $4.3 billion. This was only possible because of the $7.9 billion proceeds received from the Vic Roads Modernisation Joint Venture arrangement, which is really a fancy roundabout way of saying partial privatisation. A $3.6 billion operating cash deficit would have resulted without these proceeds. Will the government be considering any further privatisation to curtail this debt?
Minister.
And I'll allow the Treasurer to add that to his response to Mr. Lembrick.
Minister Erdogan with Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. Last week I had the pleasure of visiting the Greyhound Adoption Program at Tarrengower Prison. I was joined by my colleague in the other place, the Speaker of the Legislative Assembly, a member for Bendigo West, Marie Edwards. The Grand Adoption Program first started at Dungawa Prison in 2007 and commenced at Tarrengower Prison in 2009. It was started in recognition of the rehabilitative effects that caring for and training dogs can have for people in custody. Delivered in partnership with Greyhound Racing Victoria, former racing dogs are trained by selected participants over a four-week period to ensure they are suitable for adoption. The dogs are schooled in walking on a lead, basic obedience training, and adapting to life in a home. Through this fantastic initiative, hundreds of dogs have been rehomed and have no doubt become much-loved members of families right across Victoria. But the dogs are not the only ones who benefit from this program. We know that people leaving prison with a skill or trade and connections to the community are more likely to successfully reintegrate into the community and are less likely to reoffend. The Greyhound Adoption Program serves this objective by providing the opportunity for participants to gain valuable new skills that can assist with their ability to find new employment once released. There's also an opportunity to obtain an animal management qualification through a partnership with Bendigo, Kangan, TAFE. Rehabilitation and reintegration programs like the Greyhound Adoption Program are invaluable in providing people in custody with the important skills and self-esteem to support their reintegration back into the community. That improves community safety for all of us. I am proud that our correction system in Victoria is providing an opportunity for people in custody to work together and achieve a common goal, benefiting both the Greyhounds and women at Tarrengower Prison.
Mr. Mulholland with a question, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister for Mental Health. Minister, you've been in the job for a few months now and had time to consider the latest version of the Lay report. When will you release the short list of sites within the CBD?
Minister.
Oh, thank Mr. Mulholland for his question, a question that I think I've had a couple of times since becoming the Mental Health Minister 2 months ago. I have had the opportunity to read, digest and fully get my head around the Ken Lay report. I do want to thank Mr. Lay for his extensive work in this important policy area. We absolutely understand that there is significant drug harm going on in the CBD, and as a result of some changed patterns in drug use, we did extend Mr. Lay's work until the end of May this year. So I have had the opportunity to read his report. What I will say is that these are complex matters that the government is in the process of considering. The government will release Mr. Lay's report in due course and respond to the recommendations that are contained in the report.
Mr. Mulholland with a supplementary.
Thank you. The government's had the latest version of the report. There's been quite a few, but have had the latest version of the report for 7 months. Will you provide certainty to CBD businesses and residents and commit that you will not put an injecting room in a Salvation Army site on Bourke Street or the former Urala building in Flinders Street?
Yes or no?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr Mulholland for his supplementary. And as I've indicated in the House previously, there's been no decision made about the location of a CBD supervised injecting service. And as I've already indicated, the government is in the process of considering the report. I have been the mental health minister for 2 months, and the government will respond to Mr Lay's report in due course, and I've got nothing further to add today.
Order. As I advertised, there's actually a spare question. Would anyone like to ask the last question? Ms Crozier.
Thank you. President, as Mrs Deeming isn't in the House, I will ask the question to the Minister for Children. Minister, I refer to the Commission for Children and Young People's recently released report, Let Us Learn, Systemic Inquiry into the Educational Experiences of Children and Young People in Out-of-Home Care. The inquiry found there was an 83% increase in the number of children aged 9 to 11 in residential care and a 33% increase in children aged 6 to 8 since 2019. Minister, how can you guarantee the safety of these young children given the high numbers of sexual exploitation, abuse, criminal activity, self-harm and other serious incidents that are occurring in residential care?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Ms Crozier, for the question. And there certainly is a lot in that question from the Commissioner's Let Us Learn report through to residential care, the age of children in residential care, and also sexual exploitation of children and vulnerable children in particular. So, I mean, there's a lot in that one question. Can I firstly thank the Commissioner for Children and Young People for her report? This is a report I've discussed with her a number of times across the, and indeed also with the Commissioner for Indigenous Children and Young People, Meena Singh, as well. This report is an important report, and it's one of the reasons that I'm particularly excited about the new Premier having seen the opportunity to create a portfolio for children and indeed a more holistic approach to bringing together the needs of vulnerable children and young people, and in particular children and young people in our care system, with our early education and care settings, our education settings, and of course our maternal and child health settings, because we know that families and children don't exist in silos, and the opportunity to bring together and wrap around all of those services around children and young people is indeed so important, and indeed does go to many of the matters that the Commissioner has raised in the Let Us Learn report. And indeed she herself, in acknowledging both in relation to the work that she's done through Let Us Learn and other comments she's made around her annual report and indeed the creation of this portfolio, has also recognised that the government is prioritising children and young people, particularly vulnerable children and young people, in the creation of a holistic portfolio that goes both to child and protection and family services, alongside the education services and the maternal and child health services that allow us to deliver for these children and young people. To go specifically to the elements that you raised in relation to residential care, children who and young people who end up in our residential care facilities are indeed amongst the most vulnerable and in many instances the most complex of children in our care system. They are children who have highly complex needs, from their health and wellbeing needs through to their education needs, through to the daily services that we wrap around those children. And indeed, as we've talked about a number of times in this chamber in relation to many of the questions that Dr. Bark has asked in the past, the wraparound services that we provide around these children are so important, and the budget investment that we've made to ensure that we are providing wraparound services around all of the children in residential care is crucial. Those budget announcements also included additional supports for combating the exploitation of children and vulnerable young people in care. In particular, we're funding extra sexual exploitation practice lead, so that we are across the entire state, across all 17 regions, rolling out a response to those people, those revolting people who might prey on children and young people in our care system who are most vulnerable.
Ms. Crozier, supplementary.
Thank you, President. And Minister, thank you for that response. As you identified, there are some very vulnerable children that are under the care of the state, and these increase in numbers, I think, are a concern to all. So, Minister, can you guarantee that none of those young children that have been identified, or the increase in numbers that have been identified since the Commissioner released the report, have experienced any form of harm?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Ms. Crozier, for the question. Indeed, as I said, the children and young people in our residential care facilities in particular, but children across the whole of our child protection and family services system are vulnerable children. They are complex people. And very, very sadly, there are people in our community who seek to prey on people of all ages who might be vulnerable or have complex needs. What we are doing is investing more in the child protection and family services system than ever before, more than $3 billion in recent times. Our budget very specifically went to providing money for sexual exploitation practice leads, as I said, across the entire state, so that we are ensuring that we are working with police, so that we're ensuring... Sorry, Ms. Crozier, if you'd allow me the opportunity to complete my answer to your question. As I said, we're investing more in child protection family services than ever before, more than $3.1 billion in recent times, and in just the last budget, we invested significantly in fighting and seeking to combat those people who seek to prey on children and young people in vulnerable positions.
Ms. Shing with a Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. Now, on the question of renewable energy, energy efficiency and lower household bills across social housing, I was so delighted to be at Dunlop Avenue in Ascot Vale at the beginning of this week. It's one of our recently completed big housing build sites. It's got 200 new social and affordable homes. They've been expertly designed and they're energy efficient and equipped to meet tenants' needs in a range of different ways. It also, this particular location has the most beautiful communal open spaces, including a community garden, and it was wonderful to meet with Omar, one of the residents there, in that great garden, which the renters have planted out with all sorts of things, to talk about the impact of the local energy network arrangement, which is in partnership with Energy On, delivering renewable energy and energy efficiency to that site, including through 405 kilowatts of solar energy coming from PV panels. These sites are across the board required to have at least 5% components of electricity from on-site solar, and the remainder is sourced from off-site renewable energy. We're doing this across a number of parts of Melbourne, and this includes in Ashburton at the Markham Estate, which the Coalition alongside the Greens actually opposed, Ascot Vale, Heidelberg West, Hawthorne and North Richmond. And what we will be doing is seeing that renters continue to save hundreds of dollars a year below the Victorian default offer, which then means that they have an opportunity to meet the cost of living in another way through that measure of assistance. It's also important to note that renters have the opportunity to opt out, but in the case of Dunlop Avenue, not one has asked to do so. And a big shout out to Eliza Amalale from Evolve Housing, who showed me around this wonderful estate.
That ends Minister's statements and questions.